Okay, welcome everybody. So imagine that we are the people who have the power to do whatever we want on the planet. The people in this room, we're the decision makers. It's not anybody else. Just imagine that. Could we, the people in this room, design a system that worked for everyone? We can throw out all the traditional paradigms. Everything we know about what's happening socially, economically, politically, in terms of, we don't have to do any of that. All we have to do as a group of people here is to design something that would work for everybody, to take care of everybody on the planet in the most beneficial way for everybody. Could we do it?
Absolutely.
Okay, so the solution is out there. The way to start with doing this is that most people have no idea what it would look like. So what if we created a community, say, of 500 people, and we designed it in a way that worked for everybody, so that everybody was living incredibly abundant lives, healthy, connected, and by that I mean connecting within themselves and with other people, because most of the people on the planet have no idea what it's like to really connect with other people, because very few people have done the inner journey to really connect with themselves. And these people were living in a way that they had far less stress, they were working less, they were more integrated with nature, and they were having much more fun. So other people looking at this, they would say, you know, those people are living a whole lot better than we are. What do we need to do to get from here to there? And that is what's going to change the planet. It's not going to be a struggle against the existing model. It's not going to be a struggle to try and change anything. It's going to be that vision. And if we can then take that community and make a cluster of communities that's like five or six, so we're dealing with about 3,000 people, so that the world can see it. And the way we design everything and the way we do everything, that is going to be what changes everything else. Here's what I'm going to present to you. There is a solution. I just gave it to you. And the solution for everything is the solution to anything. I have friends challenge me. I say, give me a problem. Give me a problem, and they give me any problem. One of my friends says, I've got a headache right now. And I showed him how the solution that I just presented to you is the solution for everybody else. I think the one thing I don't cover is when person A likes person B who likes person C, I don't get into that, but still the community would address that. We have arrived at the place that we're at because of our every person for themselves system. That is at the source of most of the problems that we have. And that the way we live together and relate together in community is the basic building block needed to transform this planet. And you notice when I say community, and every place you see community in my book, it's a capital C, so that it can be differentiated with the traditional concept that people have of community, small c. When I talk community, I'm talking the vision that I just presented to you. My story. When I was around 15 years old, I read a book that was called Lemuria, The Lost Continent of the Pacific, and it talked about how community life was in Lemuria. And I got very inspired about how, if we were living that way at this time, that it could change everything else on the planet, that it would end hunger, address poverty, address all the inequalities, the imbalances, because these people really considered themselves one family. So I got all excited about that idea because I was interested only in transforming the planet and only in something that would address everything else, or else I wasn't interested. And eventually I figured out, oh, I've got to get this vision so that people can see it, so that people know what I'm talking about. So I got together with a group of people and we created a class through the Peace Theological Seminary in Los Angeles, which was to design and put down on paper a description of the community. I thought it was going to be a 10-week class. At the end of the first meeting, I could tell that the class had different ideas in mind, because I was going to just cover things like, okay, well, how's it going to work with administration and decision making? How's it going to work with economics? How's it going to work in terms of food production? And it was like, no, those are the boring questions. We need to ask some more expansive questions. So this 10-week class became a lot longer than that. But the first thing they wanted to do was to take a look at what was happening on the planet currently. And so we pretended like we were from the planet Cungawungajunga. It's not my word. Somebody else in the class came up with it. We even created a little dance that was called the Cungawungajunga. And so we were starting having a lot of fun with these concepts, which is part of the essence of the creative process. So on this planet, Cungawungajunga, where we came from, for 1,000 years, we lived in a way that we were considered all one family. That was where we were coming from. That there were no such words as poverty or lack or wealth, even, because there was no comparative thing. It wasn't that anybody had more or less. We were one family. We'd made it work for everybody. It was from renewable resources. So we weren't mining the planet for everything. It had been completely sustainable for 1,000 years. But the planet was considered to be all ours. There was no divisions in terms of, I've got to enclose, this is my space. Or this country, this is ours and it's not yours. It's like the whole planet was considered ours. That there was no isolation and alienation because everybody had connected inside and therefore they knew how to connect with other people. And in fact, they knew how to connect with nature, as we're finding more and more that all things have life. And of course, our Native American friends have known that for a long time. That everyone was supported to maximize their potential. This was not we were not a lazy society just because we'd had it work for everyone, but everyone was encouraged to bring forward those inner gifts within them. And that we all lived according to the guidelines of the highest good for all. And you'll hear that mentioned again and again and again by me and in the book, because that's what I called the design itself that we came up with. It's for the highest good of all. Okay, so then this 10-week class became 3 years, meeting about every week. And at the end of that time, we came up with our vision that we wrote in a 45-page paper. And after we had that, then we created the nonprofit Community Planet Foundation. So here's our situation that we've got on the planet right now, and I know that most of you know this, but the planet the way it is, according to how we do things in the United States, could support about 2 billion people if it was exported to everybody, or else we would need 6 planets, which we don't have. But that's what we've got going in terms of the lifestyle in this country, and we're exporting that everywhere. So people love to speak in sound bites. So here's a sound bite for you. The political systems are broken. And here's another one. The economic systems are broken. So a little detail on the first one. This is from Supreme Court Justice Louis Brandeis. We do not have a representative democracy in the United States. We have an unequal democracy where the major decisions that affect our lives are driven by power, money, interests. We need to return to the people the decision making that affects their everyday lives. And we all know this, and this is very, very obvious, and yet the system goes on as if There are no other choices. And a second quote from Mussolini, fascism should more properly be called corporatism, since it is the merger of state and corporate power. Does that sound like any place we know? And competitive society will always have people at the bottom who have too little to balance those at the top that have too much. That is the essence of the every person for themselves system. Our economic system has impoverished the planet at the expense of most of its inhabitants. But as I said, instead of reining it in, we're exporting it everywhere on Earth as if capitalism, according to the United States and Western Europe, is that's the fundamental thing that everybody has to have. Six planets. There is something fundamentally wrong with treating the Earth as if it were a business in liquidation. And you know, anybody responsible knows this, is that we're mining the Earth at such an extent that we just simply cannot continue. The time estimates are differing, but I think there's common agreement that within the next 20, 30 years that the quality of life for everybody on the planet is going to be greatly diminished. And that includes the people at the top as well. So how did we get to this place that we're at? Again, I submit to you that for thousands of years, unquestioned on the planet, there have been variations of this legacy of the every person for themselves system. It's like we're in this hypnotic place where we think that's the way it has to be, because that's the way it's always been. It's like Darwin's survival of the fittest. I mean, it's like, so what? There's people at the top. They say if we redistributed the money, it'd all fall back into the same hands anyway. That's the justification for doing it the way we're doing it. But the mediums of exchange, at first money was thought to be a convenience, that it made things easier, so I didn't have to take a big pig, to trade for a basket, to trade for a cow, that it just made, to have some shells, it just made the system of exchange between one village or region and another, it made it easier. And then, at some point, it's like it took over, so that money itself became the monster. And now it's like, well, we can't do something, we can't address poverty, we can't address the infrastructure, we can't address healthcare, because we don't have enough of this. If we had more of this, we could fix all those things. And yet, what is this? These were the shells. This was just what they used as to say we can't do something because there's not enough money, is to say we can't do something because there's not enough cooperation. And yet, when they have a major earthquake, they say, oh, this is a good thing because it could aid economic growth. Whenever there's a crisis, a war, a natural disaster or something, they say, oh, economically, this is a good thing, because it frees up the money. Where did the money come from? To have a war, where did the money come from to fix things that needed to be fixed or to do things in a different way? It's not the money, it's the every person for themselves system. This system has bred separation and againstness. Separation in terms of classes, separation in terms of access to other people, as we don't consider ourselves one family, but we put boundaries around, well, this is mine and I got to protect this. And that the other thing that's happened is that we've had no ideas how to work in groups of people. I've had years and years of doing team building and with many corporations, with many groups of people. And what I saw was that there was hardly anybody who had any idea how to do a group initiative, how to really communicate effectively to do it. This one time I was doing this event for the very sharpest people from BMW, I mean the geniuses from around the world who were the best and the facilitator. So we're going to really have to challenge these people because they're going to be very sharp. I thought to myself, yeah, I wonder. And sure enough, they were just a little worse than the average group of people because nobody had any idea how to collectively get together and make a decision that would be for the highest good of the group. So everything was either built, everything that you see out there was either built haphazardly or it was built autocratically. It was never built by a group of people like us getting together and say, what's really going to work in terms of the design for everybody? So communities were built by, first a building came, a person put one thing up, and then a person put another house up or another building, and somebody came in and put a business up. And then you ended up with something looking a little bit like, you see, we take the farmland, and then we say, okay, let's put up some houses. Doesn't that look like an attractive place to live? I wonder if any of these people know many of their neighbors. But again, this is survival in the every person for themselves system. In terms of the solution, again, the systems theory in physics is telling us now that everything is interconnected. There's even some great quotes in there by John Muir and some other people on that hanging up in the hall there. And so we can't really change anything by railing against one cause or another. It's just not going to work. Again, I submit to you that by railing against one point or another, it's like putting Band-Aids on problems. That's all we're doing when we're doing that. This from the World Commission on Environment and Development. They say the time has come to break out of past patterns, attempts to maintain social and ecological stability. Through old approaches to development and environmental protection will increase instability. Security must be sought through change. This commission has noted a number of actions that must be taken to reduce risk to survival and to put future development on paths that are sustainable. And in bold, I say, yet we are aware that such a reorientation on a continuing basis is simply beyond the reach of present decision-making structures and institutional arrangements, both national and international. That's because they recognize that the governments and the big businesses, they're never going to be able to institute the changes that are necessary because they can't create the vision that I laid out to you originally. And because everything is interconnected, their attempts at trying to fix anything is, again, just going to be a Band-Aid approach. It's not going to be a government that changes things. It's going to be a community of 3,000 people that changes the planet. Again, that solution has to come from recognizing that everything is interconnected. So again, the solution for everything is the solution to anything. The first step would be to create this model community that I'm talking about, with the intention on the scale that is needed to attract worldwide interest. I'm guessing that's about 3,000 people, and I'll get into a little bit of why that's so later. But again, as I said, the quality of life has to be at a point where people can look at what these people are doing and say, that's very different. They're far more abundant, they're far more healthy and happy, and I want to be there. To toss out that is unnecessary with the way we've set up our economic system is we've created jobs and nonsense products for people to try and survive on their own that are simply unnecessary. The other thing that has to happen is that we can't retrofit existing communities. In my mind, that this model that's going to transform everything has to be created with absolute integrity in terms of its design, its sustainability, its energy sources, its water sources, and in a way that it looks like an Epcot Center kind of a design. So it's not like taking an existing community and saying, oh, okay, we'll just try and make this every person, this model that was designed on the every person for themselves system, and try and make it work for the highest good of all. It's like, no, we need to create a model that stands as like, wow, That's very different. The size of about 500 people, as I said, in the cluster, I went over that earlier. The community belongs to everyone. That has to be part of the model. And that would mean no individual ownership of the land, of the houses, because then people could inherit their way in. And it's going to take the consciousness, the people who are there holding the consciousness to do this, as well as just living in the form. And again, this model has to be based on the highest good for all. So our group came up with, when we were, as I said, they wanted to ask more expansive questions. So we, in describing the 45-page document and covering how the community would work, these are the concepts we came up with that covered every aspect of the community. The first one, how do we share our abundance, is we decided that the thing to do was to redefine wealth as use and access rather than possession. I was just at my nephew's house a couple of nights ago, and the amount of plastic things that they have for toys for their kids are just amazing. And it's just amazing the amount of stuff that each of us has that if we were sharing these things, we would need far, far fewer of these kinds of things. We don't need a swimming pool in our backyard or a tennis court in our backyard. We just need access to things that we don't have to own. We don't need, for 500 people, how many cars do you think we would really need for 500 people? If it's a pedestrian community, that most of us are living and working there, that we're walking every place that we're going, and the only time we need a car is to leave there and go someplace else. We would probably need definitely fewer than 40 cars for 500 people. And the savings on that, I mean, if we're talking even in terms of monetary, is just amazing by the time we talk about insurance and maintenance and upkeep and everything else. We don't need a boat if we're living by the ocean, you know, like we don't need a boat for everybody. We just need access to a boat. If you look in any harbor and it's like, those boats are going unused 99% of the time. This is my version of the economic system, that it was supposed to be that manpower plus resources plus a medium of exchange, that would equal abundance for the planet. And yet, in the every person for themselves system, the manpower, it's like one person out of six is engaged in something that's actually adding to producing something beneficial for the planet. And then all the resources that go to supporting those other 5/6 of the people, all the paper that's produced, all the nonsense products that are produced, it's just an incredible, and all the energy to light the buildings where these people go to work, and all the professions, most of the legal profession, most of the economic profession, a lot of the retail profession, don't really have to exist in a cooperative society. So money is the immediate exchange. We get a little bit of abundance. We get inequality and poverty, and we just basically destroy the planet. In a highest good for all system, we've got cooperation as the medium of exchange. So that leads to abundance, not only for everyone, but for all life on the planet, because we've got to consider nature as our partner. Sustainability and replenishing the planet's resources, which we would have the manpower to do, actually, at that point, and peace. And my favorite cartoon in my book, it's my book, I put in cartoons. You can read that for yourself. And the next topic was how do we reach consensus? So we define consensus not in terms of how politically they define consensus, which is just compromise, but instead, the essence of consensus really is creativity. If we're not in consensus as a group, chances are that we haven't exercised all the creativity that we need. And our group of five people that was putting together this vision, we had the one woman in our group who was very intuitive. The rest of us would come up intellectually with a concept. We thought, okay, this is it, and we'd get all excited about it, and we'd say, well, what do you think? Because we decided we were going to do everything by consensus, and we couldn't really record anything as being through with that until everyone had agreed. So she would say, that's not it. And we would say, what do you mean that's not it? This is it. This is great. And she'd say, it's not it. And so we'd say, well, what's wrong? And she'd say, I don't know. And we'd say, well, how would you do it? I don't know. I just know that it's not it. And so we'd have to put things on hold until the next week. We'd come back hoping she had changed her mind. This is not it. So eventually, out of resignation, we'd have to say, okay. And then we just got goofy and started coming up with crazy ideas and having fun with it and throwing out this, that, and the other thing. And in that process, we would hit upon something and build upon something, and then we'd move to a whole other level in terms of how we were thinking about it and how we were going to describe it. And then she would say, that's it. And if we had not been honoring, through consensus, everybody's voice in the group, even if they don't have the solution, we never would have been able to get the kind of description and the quality of description that we had. And so I learned something about consensus. We later developed a training, a consensus decision-making training that we did several of those. The couples who took it said it was the best couples training they'd ever had. And I thought, I wonder why that is. It's because you really have to learn how to communicate with other people and how to listen and how to take responsibility for what's happening inside. We've become a collection of minority groups in this country, and that's what the majority rules systems, that's what democracies do. And any kind of system where there's voting, that's what it does, because everybody eventually feels disenfranchised about something, so that's why politically they always vote against things. And so Gandhi, he says that, well, you can read it, but he says that he doesn't believe in this doctrine of the majority rules because he says it's a heartless doctrine that has done harm to humanity. The only real dignified human doctrine is the greatest good of all. You must have read my book. How do we reach, how do we interact with our environment? There's ways to create all our own energy systems, to create all our own water. The technology is there. A lot of it has been suppressed. There's even traditional ways of doing this, as our friend Atsuo was describing some of the latest technology in terms of solar cells, or in terms of solar energy. But there's, even without going into the kinds of things that have been, that we haven't been able to do because of the economic forces that would stop people, there's still traditional things that can be done. How do we beautify our environment? There's several of these drawings around the room that about how things could look as contrasted with that earlier drawing that you saw. How do we enjoy ourselves? We're going to have to start learning to live with more fun in our lives. That in a community like this, imagine what you could do in a community like this where you're connected with people, where you can share resources, where you can share musical instrument or plays. Whatever your interests are, there would be people that you could share that with. You wouldn't have to buy all these things and have them in your closet or in your garage. There are people to do things with. People have lost the concept of play because they think, well, it's too hard. I go to work. I come back from all the commuting. I'm stressed out. And I don't have enough energy. And to think about getting up, I might as well go to the gym because that's where I can get some exercise. And they exercise on the machines. Remember when we were kids, we used to play. Get out and actually play with people and do things and interact. And that's been lost. And we can get it back in these communities. How do we coordinate what we love to do? Again, most of the jobs that exist don't need to exist. And a lot of the jobs that are undesirable, it's simply a matter of creatively figuring out another way to do it or making them more fun. And out of the how do we enjoy ourselves, there'll be a minister of fun, and their job is going to be go around and help everybody make things fun. Well, the UN says that the stress is going to be one of the major health issues in the world. And the top seven selling drugs, all for stress. How do we nourish ourselves? Food right now, average in the United States, 1,500 miles to market. We can create local, edible landscaping and local food production using permaculture, using the techniques. We don't need to use chemicals, which are an incredible problem. And how do we vitalize ourselves? Preventative medicine and healthcare available for everybody. This is one area where we're going to need more jobs, incidentally, is there's no reason why we shouldn't each of us, and I don't think I'd find anybody in the room disagreeing with me, each of us at least one massage a week. So that's the one job classification that we'll need more of, is more massage technicians. How do we bring forth inner wisdom? The community itself is going to be a school. And it's this question is very different from the traditional question, which is, how do we teach you what we want you to know? How do we communicate? This is both workshops and communication. It's also covers the technology of communication. If you remember back to that hub system, we figured out a way technologically where the entire 500-person community could make decisions by consensus. And finally, how do we expand our community? This hub group has the responsibility, and everybody would be in one of these 12 hub groups, as well as in another hub, which we call Essence Hubs, which is where people get together and are in the decision-making process. But these are hubs that involve the various aspects of work in the community. And how do we expand has the responsibility both for screening people so that they know how to work consensus, they hold the consciousness of the highest good, and only then can they be a part of the decision-making structure of the community. And their other responsibility is, how do we get this vision out to the planet? Because remember, this is not an isolated community, but this community has the responsibility of changing the planet. This is an example of the cluster. I said it'd take a cluster of about six communities to create 3,000. Might look something like that. Bucky Fuller said, in order to change something, we've gone over this before, don't struggle to change the existing model, create a new one and make the old one obsolete. My friend Margaret supplied the quote that's made it on the back cover of the second edition of the book, because this is really the essence of what has to happen. Okay, so if we don't do it, well, you see what happens. Our place in history, this is what's going to happen 50 years from now if we do nothing. What will they say? They're going to say we engaged in financially driven chemical experimentation in terms of global warming and everything we're doing to the air, water, and land, that we basically used up the planet's resources without regard to future generations, without regard to the quality of life for our grandchildren. The historians will absolutely write about our time and say these things about us right now, unless we do something different. And how we bowed to big money and power broker interests, because we said, oh, these people, we couldn't do anything about those people because they had all the power to make all the decisions. Well, they do have the power to make the decisions in that paradigm, but as Bucky said, we just need to create a different paradigm completely. And that we considered the planet's problems too big, too scary to think about, so we just basically said, well, hope for the best. And that's where a lot of the people are. They're asleep and hoping for the best. But not us. There are enough resources and there's enough power on the planet for life to work for everyone. But we're not doing it because of the legacy for the every person for themselves approach. It's now time that we do something different. And again, I say to you that the way we live together and relate together in community is the basic building block needed to transform the planet, and in fact, I believe, is the only building block that will transform the planet, because it just can't be done within the existing structure. The new paradigm can only be created by a group of people who absolutely hold the consciousness of the highest good for all and have the vision to bring that into manifestation. This model is not something that you can just take anybody and say, okay, well, let's do it. It takes the education and consciousness to do it. And again, people need to see that there's a better way. We need to create that model out there for people to look at, so they say, those people are living far better than I am. How do I get from here to there? That's going to be what changes the planet. It is possible that the next Buddha will not take the form of an individual. The next Buddha may take the form of a community practicing understanding and loving kindness, a community practicing mindful living. This may be the most important thing we can do for the survival of the Earth. I must have read his book. This is how we considered, this is how we ended the postscript on the Community Planet Foundation, and every time I read it in the book, it's interesting, I'm sitting there reading it by myself, and every time I read this, it gets me misty. We believe that the keys to world peace and prosperity are recognizing our oneness with all life, having a consciousness of sharing and cooperation, and acting and loving. If we lived in those ways, we could eliminate hunger, poverty, and the isolation and alienation of those who are perceived as being different from ourselves. The idea of community has come forth to provide a working model for living together in greater harmony with ourselves, each other, and all life on the planet. It is our hope that historians will look back at this time and write something like, the people of the early 21st century recognized that they had to wake up and stop doing life as it has been done for thousands of years. They realized that to survive, it could no longer be me versus you or us versus them, but that it had to be just us. They finally realized that they had all the resources and manpower to make the world work for everyone, and they just did it. And so, may we just do it.
Jack, I had one question, if I may. I really appreciated your vision and commitment to a future, because I don't think we have one right now. But the question I have is, the initial comment that you made saying that the solution for everything is within the context of doing something or anything, and I want to explore that a little bit more, because I think I understand what you're saying, where a solution for war is not against war, it's about creating peace. So anything that you do towards peace is going to be solving everything? Is that the the concept that you're expanding there? If you could comment on that, please.
No, actually. The solution for everything is the solution to anything. And what I submit to you is that solution for everything is specifically for a group of people to get together who hold the consciousness of the highest good and who live in the form of the highest good and model to the rest of the world how they too can do that. And then those communities from that first model or models then expand and expand and expand until the entire planet eventually is a collection of these communities. And when I talk about the solution for everything is the solution to anything, that's what I'm talking about, is that one solution addresses everything else. It's interesting, the number of people who communicate with me, who find me somehow on the internet and write to me, and when I write back to them, I say, you probably felt like you wrote the book, because so many people, when they read it, they so identify with it, it's like, because it was their idea. And I just took a lot of time and wrote a book. But this is not my idea. It's not even our little group that put together the vision. It's not that idea. This is an idea that the Buddhist master has said, and this idea is recognized all over the world. And if we come together and do this as a group of people, create this plan. Barbara Marx Hubbard once asked me on the internet radio show, she once said, well, how much is it going to take to do this? And at the time I answered her, I gave her a figure monetarily. And then later I realized that was the wrong answer, because I was just answering the question the way she'd asked it. The real answer to the question is, it would take just one person. There's a lot of people out there who've got the resources to make this thing happen or to facilitate this happening. And it would only require getting in touch with one or a couple of these people, and we can do this. And the people, believe me, the people are out there who want to be a part of this thing, because I'm communicating with a small fraction of those people, but there's thousands upon thousands of people that know that this is what has to happen and would love to be a part of this. So this is going to be a very easy thing to do.